Good evening, everyone. You're all very welcome to our event, Waste Less, Moving Towards a Circular Food System. My name is Aishna Gokia, and I'm your host for the evening. We are delighted to be hosting this event as part of Kildare Climate and Energy Week. This is the first time Kildare County Council has held such an event, and we are absolutely delighted to be involved in this important initiative. First of all, we would like to extend a big thanks to SEAI and Creative Ireland for their support and all other organizations that have been involved in making this happen. So some housekeeping before we begin. This webinar is being recorded and will be available to view online later. We are delighted to be joined by Ashlyn Kirwan, co-founder and COO of Positive Carbon, and Kieran Coffey, CTO of Mygug. Today, they'll be shedding light on one of the most important topics, food waste, and how we can move towards reducing the impact of food waste on the environment. If you are tweeting about this event, please use the hashtag #TimeToSwitchOn, and you can use the chat function to put in any queries and questions that you may have. We'll be taking them after each speaker session. So without further ado, I would like to invite Ashlyn to share her journey and tell us a bit more about Positive Carbon. Ashlyn has worked in the food industry for the past 6 years, rolling out food waste projects across Ireland, the UK, Australia, and Chile. Having studied biochemistry and cell biology in Trinity College Dublin, Ashlyn wanted to redirect her focus on sustainability and the environment. She began working in Food Cloud in 2015 when it was a small team and managed accounts for some of the biggest retailers across Ireland, including Aldi, Lidl and Musgrave, then joining a similar organization in Australia, where she led a similar rollout of a food reduction project, a food waste reduction project for Woolworths across the entire continent. In 2020, Ashlyn co-founded Positive Carbon, and since then the team has been helping hotels and catering companies across Ireland on monitoring and reducing their food waste. And now I'll pass it on to Ashlyn.
Hi, thanks for that, Asna. Hi, everyone. Let me just share my screen and... Is that okay? Brilliant. So yes, with that introduction, my name is Ashlyn. I'm the co-founder and COO of Positive Carbon. So I'm just going to speak to you today a little bit about the problem of food waste and how we've come up with the solution that we created in order to help commercial kitchens start to identify and monitor their food waste and then ultimately reduce it. So first things first, the climate crisis is one of the biggest threats facing us today. And food waste is one of the largest contributors to that threat. So one third of all food that's produced globally is wasted. So it contributes to 10% of all greenhouse gas emissions. That's actually five times more than the aviation industry. So I think when a lot of people think about climate change and their impact and what they could do, I think cutting flights is a quick one that people jump to, but reducing food waste as an issue is actually five times more powerful than the aviation industry, because reducing food waste is the single greatest solution to remove CO2 from the atmosphere. And that's a quote from Project Drawdown, who do a lot of statistics for the UN in around food waste and other issues as well. So there's a huge global problem of wasting 1.3 billion tons of food, but in Ireland alone, we waste 1 million tons. So for a very small country, we have an absolutely huge input on the amount of food waste that's created. So Positive Carbon was founded by myself and my co-founder, Mark. As Esna already gave a slight introduction to, we have both been working in the food waste industry together for the past 6 years. We got our start in the industry working at Food Cloud, who I don't think there's anyone in Ireland who doesn't know what Food Cloud does now, but just in case, they work with food retailers to help redistribute their surplus food to local charities that can use the food. And that ultimately then reduces their entire, reduces the food waste that they're producing. So from there, Mark was working in the tech side of things. He was creating reporting dashboards for all of Food Cloud stakeholders so they could view what was being donated to charity, what wasn't, and getting a full view of what was working and what wasn't. And then I was working in operations on that side. So my job was to actually roll out the technology to the retailers across Ireland and in Northern Ireland, and also with one of their stakeholders in Australia as well. So it was a big task at the time. We both then moved from Ireland to Australia to work on a similar organization there. The idea again was Mark was building reporting dashboards for these retailers to use on redistribution foods, and then it was my role to actually roll out the technology to the retailers and to the local charities. So because of it being able to introduce this tech, the organization was able to reach new areas in Australia that they'd never been able to work in before. So previously, they'd worked in the main cities in Melbourne and Sydney, Brisbane, the likes, but now they're able to reach the outback of Australia and reach every town and community and being able to use this tech. So that was really fantastic. From there, we were invited to Chile to work on a food initiative there, but we were probably there for the extent of 4 weeks before the entire country shut down because of the pandemic, and we were very strongly advised to get out of the country with the embassy. So once we did get home, we wanted to focus all our efforts back in Ireland and see if we could start trying to tackle food waste within the food service industry, which is one of the largest creators of food waste, but didn't really seem to have a solution for it. So if we just look at food waste caused across different sectors across the EU, if we exclude households, which are a huge contributor to food waste, but it's not where our expertise lay at all, then food waste, food service industry is the largest contributor to food waste by far, when you compare it to any of the other sectors. So it's an entire €21 billion every year that's produced by this sector across Europe. And if we just look to break down that 21 billion a bit further to understand why it's so high, a lot of the food, there's always going to be a certain amount of food waste. Food waste is inevitable in a food service industry. However, it's the makeup of that food waste that we want to look at. So there is always your unavoidable food waste. So this is bones, trimmings, peelings, the food shells is another good one. Things that are produced in the process of making food, but they're not edible and they are always going to end up in the brown bin. However, we want to look at the other side, which is the 62%, which is the more easily preventable food waste. This is food that was just thrown in the, was purchased, transported, stored, brought to these establishments and then thrown in the bin. It's food that didn't need to be wasted. So it either could have been not purchased in the first place, reused in a different way, or just had smarter planning and organizing to make sure that it didn't get wasted. And that's the area that we really want to focus on. So it's a €21 billion problem across Europe. In Ireland, it's €30 million is spent on the food service industry on food that is thrown into the bin, which is absolutely a shocking number. So when we break that down, it means that there's some food service operators that are spending €1,000 a day on preventable food waste. So if you just think about that for a second, that's the same as a business owner who puts everything into this business to make it as efficient and well run as possible, just taking €1,000, walking over to the brown bin and throwing it in. The problem is that food waste can often be seen as an inevitability, so there's not as much focus on it. While, you know, if €1,000 has been wasted in another aspect of a business, it's very unlikely it'd be allowed to continue on for very long. But there's no real oversight on food waste within a commercial kitchen at the moment. And because it's seen as an inevitability, that's what we really want to change. It's not. This waste doesn't need to be happening. So why does the food service industry produce so much waste? This is where we really wanted to start when we first started the business, was finding out all the reasons why. We spent months of research at the very beginning to find out why it is, because we wanted to build a solution to solve a problem rather than building something and trying to force it into businesses when it just wasn't going to work. So we spent the first 3-4 months of the business just on a research phase. It was in the depths of one of the worst lockdowns, so we were primarily focused on hotels because they're the largest wastes of food. And it just meant that we were able to speak to general managers and head chefs, who are people who are normally working 60-hour weeks and don't have a second to spare, suddenly had a bit more time in their hands and were very generous with their time. And we are actually able to sit down and speak to a lot of people that I don't think weeks of hounding during normal times we've ever gotten to sit down with before. So that was a really beneficial time for us to understand exactly what the problem was and how we wanted to actually fix it then. So from that research, it seemed that when we were speaking to chefs and general managers, the biggest problem was visibility of the problem. So they knew there was food waste, they knew it was costing them money, but if they didn't know what they were wasting, it's very difficult for them to enact changes to actually stop wasting it. So we wanted to then draw on our experience from working with food retailers. Food retailers, although they're buying in absolutely millions of euros of food every single month, they typically only waste, well, from our experience, typically only waste between, it can be as low as 1-2% of all food that they're bringing in. While hotels on average can be 10%, and I've seen cases when it's lower, but I've seen cases when it's a lot higher as well. And the discrepancy there is food retailers have a really good grasp of their food waste because of barcodes. So everything they order in is scanned in, everything that's bought by a customer is scanned out, and everything that's wasted is scanned out. So they have this line by line data of exactly what they wasted every single day. And because of that, they're able to see trends over time, they're able to see what things work over different seasons, what's selling, what's not selling, what actually works. And now they can make informed decisions based on that data that they have of what they should do to get their food waste down to that single digit percentage. And that's what we wanted to be able to recreate for commercial kitchens, so they had that same level of visibility and be able to make the same impact on their food waste. So after many, many variations on what the solution would look like, we finally came together with our patented food waste scanner. So this is an image of it here. It works on three different points. So it's only about the size of a fire alarm, it fits in your hands, and it is bolted to the ceiling or on a wall if need be over the bin in a kitchen. And it's able to detect and monitor all food waste that's thrown into the bin. So it works on a couple of different points. The first is a camera takes an image of the food as it's thrown into the bin. So we can see in this scenario that some tomatoes were thrown in on top. And then AI also labels that food as well. So it's able to say, yeah, I've identified that, that's tomatoes. While at the same time, we use a type of laser called LiDAR in order to get a 3D model or 3D map of the bin, which allows us to turn our bin into a matrix like this. And it uses complicated maths that I'm not going to pretend to understand to get the volume and the weight of that food. So now we have an image of the food, we have the food labeled, and we have the weight of the food. So I'll just play you a clip here. This is a video from a live customer that we're working with. We produce one of these videos every day with the customer so they can see exactly what they're wasting. But we can see the food building up throughout the day. It's labeled at the bottom and we can see the weight increasing as well as the food goes in. A key question we always get asked is it not just a giant mess of food going in? And I think this is a great example of how cleanly food is actually put into the bin. So you can see there, fish just went in. If a staff member is working with fish, they're prepping fish on a blue board because that's what they have to do. And then they dispose of fish all at once and then they go on to another task. So food is quite separated out within a kitchen. So it means that when it's thrown into a bin, we tend to get all broccoli at once. We get all eggshell at once. We get all bread at once. And it just means it's very, it's clear for us to be able to label and identify that food, so it makes for really good high quality data as well. And then the point of it all is to come together on analytics dashboards where our customers can see exactly what they're wasting and where. So the image here is on a phone, but it actually can be seen on a phone, on a laptop, on a computer, any kind of format that you want to view it in. And this again is an example from a real hotel that we're working in. They had a major seafood problem. They were wasting a huge amount of sole, fillets and prawns as well. So when I was able to sit down with the head chef and run him through this data, he knew exactly what to do within his kitchen to start cutting this down. The problem is he didn't know how bad the problem was before and he wasn't able to measure it. So now he can see, okay, we were wasting 557 euro on sole last week. I've made a couple of changes. What are we at next week? What are we at next following? What are we following week? And start setting KPIs to say, okay, guys in the kitchen, we're only wasting 10 kilos of fish in this week. So that's our target. Let's not go above that. And you can finally start even putting numbers on things, which make things tangible and attainable as well. So we very much see ourselves as a European project. We are only based in Ireland at the moment, but we have plans to move throughout the UK early next year and then into Germany by the end of. So just to put it in context of what we're tackling, there are 890,000 restaurants in the European Union. But then, of course, the climate crisis is a global problem and we very much want to be a global solution. So there are 15 million restaurants across the globe. And we hope that we'd be able to make the most advanced food waste technology to be able to go into every one of these businesses that would be interested in monitoring and reducing their food waste. So we've had early stage pilots with customers that have seen a 42% reduction in their food waste over a 3-month period. So that was really, really positive results for us. We'll be putting a case study together based on that in the next coming weeks, and we'll have it made public. And then just to end on the same point I started on, that reducing food waste is the single greatest solution to remove CO2 from the atmosphere. So if you have a business or know anyone who does own a business and think they can benefit from not only reducing their food bills, but reducing their waste collections, but introducing one of the easiest ways to hit sustainability goals within a business as well, please have them get in touch and I'd love to talk them through the solution more. And that's everything from me at the moment. Thanks very much for your time.
Thank you so much, Aisling, for that wonderful and absolutely informative presentation. And I do have a question right off the bat, and that would be somewhere around, do you think your solution could be scaled to a household level as well? Because as individuals, you know, we actually do end up throwing a lot from our fridge than we realize. And we, of course, be coming down to that in the next few presentations. But do you think something like that could also be used in households?
We actually have gotten asked this a few times before. So I think for households, the tech that we're working with is definitely overkill for a household, but just based on how much waste is produced in an individual household. Although across millions of households, the problem of food waste is so massive. We're working with a localized problem within one commercial kitchen where, you know, it would be the equivalent of maybe 1,000 households. So the tech that we have at the moment wouldn't work in a household in just a business model perspective. It wouldn't be affordable for a house to be introducing something where they might be wasting €700 of food a year, while a food business could be wasting €250,000. So but I do very much see with households, I think an education piece is even more important than a tech piece around it. So I know already, including yourselves, the EPA already do a lot of fantastic work around food waste awareness within the home. So I definitely think that would be that's the way to go forward at the minute. Maybe we'll, in 10 years time, our tech would be so sophisticated and cost absolutely nothing and be able to put it in every household in Ireland and the world. But yeah, it's not on the map at the moment.
Absolutely. I think we have another question. I see Kira's hand up there. Kira, do you have something?
Yeah, just to say that was fantastic, Aisling. Looks absolutely brilliant technology. Just wondering, what's the margin of error on the technology that you use, if any?
Margin error for identifying the food? Or?
Yeah, well, for identifying it and also the weight, yeah, just in general.
Yeah, so identifying the food, it's 99%. So we have the AI is keyed up on 500 plus food types. Every time we bring on a new customer, we ask them for a product list to be able to make sure that there's no new items that we need to train the models up on. We also have human eyes on it as well, which is also a good thing to verify anything that the system might not get. Then in terms of the weight, there's always a small bit of discrepancy. Same thing with scales. So a scales needs to be calibrated almost on a weekly basis. And if it's not, it will drift significantly. So based on a lot of studies, we've also learned scales would normally drift between 10 and 15% on the actual weight of the food. And our tech is coming in just underneath that. So it's in and around scales. We're also new. So we see ourselves in the next year being able to get down to it being 100%. Light doesn't change. So once we're able to get our algorithms to be absolutely perfect, then it will always be 100%.
I can see Paula and a few others typing in the chat box. We'll just give them a minute to type in their questions. Have you trialed this with supermarkets, especially those with delis and fresh food counters?
Yeah, so we're in talks with a few different delis. So there's petrol station chains that have them as well. So anytime there's a chain feature involved, when it's not an independent one, but you know, you're talking about 20, 30 locations, even a small amount of food waste across one business, once you start to scale out that, the problem gets bigger and bigger and more expensive. We have a couple of pilots lined up, but we haven't had an active one in that area yet. Again, it's just priorities. If we look at hotels or catering companies, the extent of their food waste and how much that's costing them is much more urgent than delis, because you tend to have lower amounts of waste and then lower value foods as well. So yeah, we have pilots coming up, but we have a couple of bigger fish to fry in the meantime.
I have one more question. Do you see any integration happening between Food Cloud and the Positive Carbon later down the line?
I'd always be welcome to collaborate. I absolutely love what they're doing. I've been asked this before about, like, are you trying to put Food Cloud out of business? And at that point, I was like, I think you don't understand my business model. So at the moment, we are tackling very different areas. So they're in food retailers where there's a lot of strict processes around, and it's easy to donate food. You have use by dates and best before dates on food, so it's very easy for donating food. While in the food service industry that we're in, it's food that can never be donated anyway, because we have very strict regulations in on what kind of food can be donated. So we are very much at the moment working in very different sectors, but if there was ever an opportunity to collaborate, I absolutely would, yes.
Thank you so much, Aisling, for your time today. And it was definitely an eye opener to see the amount of food, even the, you know, from the hotels that goes into the bin. I would not imagine, you know, when you're eating out at the restaurant, so much of fresh food actually goes down the bin. You would have, of course, there are leftovers from your table, but you of course feel that they would probably be binned. But looking at the live footage, it just gives you another realization. If anyone has any other questions, please feel free to put them out in the chat box. We will reach out to Aisling with your questions again after the session. And she'll try to answer them when she can. And we'll move on to our next speaker now, Kieran. Kieran is the CTO of Mygug. He is qualified as a mechanical engineer, but his passion for environment led him down the environmental engineering road back in the 90s to pursue his environmental engineering degree from Manchester University. Over the last number of years, Kieran has focused on designing a system for treating food waste at a micro scale, which has resulted in him miniaturizing the industrial process of anaerobic digestion and designing Mygug, microscale anaerobic digester, for use in homes and businesses. The stage is all yours, Kieran.
Thanks, Kira. Yeah, so this diagram here comes from a study done by the European Union, the Fusions Report, and it shows that the majority of food waste is actually produced in households and food service, so 65%. And Aisling is focused on reducing food waste. And our focus has been on providing a solution locally for households and business to treat their own food waste in an environmentally friendly way. Next slide, please, Kira. So anaerobic digestion is a well-known process on an industrial scale, and it's a natural form of waste to energy. So you've got basically large tanks with bacteria in them, and anaerobic refers to in the absence of air. So they're bacteria that operate in the absence of air, as opposed to composting where you've got aerobic bacteria. And you can treat a wide variety of organic materials, such as animal manure, food waste, and the others that you see there. Now the next slide shows the standard, the sort of large scale anaerobic digestion plants that you might see. The top one is an industrial type unit, and an agricultural one on the right, and ones that treat sewage sludge on the bottom left. Now, there's a real advantage to the egg shape in anaerobic digestion. There's two things that anaerobic bacteria like. Next slide, please, Kira. Now, the first is you need to mix an anaerobic digester very well to perform well. And the egg shape is an amazing shape for mixing, because there's no corners in which sludge or food waste or whatever you're treating can hide. And you get a really good mixing. So but my goal in designing an anaerobic digester to treat food waste locally was to harness this natural shape in our design and miniaturize the industrial process to allow people to treat food waste locally. Next slide, please, Kira. So here are examples of a number of our units that we've installed. The big one on the left was installed in a cafe, and it's capable of treating 5 tons of food waste per year and converting that food waste into the equivalent of 500 kilograms of compressed gas. And then on the right hand side, we've got the blue digester is a domestic digester, and the one on top is a small commercial unit that we installed and did 3 months testing there recently in Clonakilty. So these are units that are fully automated, and they're designed to treat food waste locally. Next slide here, thanks. So this is our domestic unit, and it's just a little bigger than a standard 240 wheelie bin. And it'll treat up to half a ton of food waste, a little over half a ton of food waste a year, about what a 5 or 6 person household will produce in food waste generally, according to the EU study. Next slide, Kira, thanks. So the design here is the digester is the egg on the left, and on the right, you can see a cabinet with the sink. And the next slide will actually, I can describe how the unit operates, if you can move it on, Kira. So the egg digester is where all the treatment happens, and you've got bacteria, the anaerobic bacteria are inside in that egg. And what a householder does is they take their food waste and they just deposit it in the sink, turn on the tap, press the macerator button, and all the food waste gets macerated and it goes into a balance tank. And we've designed automated controls then to send that food waste intermittently to the digester, where it gets broken down by those anaerobic bacteria and converted into biogas, which is about 65% methane, and most of the rest of it is carbon dioxide. And you get on the bottom left hand side, there's an overflow that you connect a hose to, and you get a very good liquid fertilizer from the process then, once it's gone through the digestion process. And next slide, please, Kira. So one of the important aspects for a digester to work reliably is warm temperature. The anaerobic bacteria don't thrive at all below sort of 20 degrees centigrade, but they really operate efficiently at our body temperature, 37, 38 degrees. So we maintain our digester's temperature, and this is the prototype that we built a number of years ago. And you can see, even though it's 37 degrees inside, there's snow on top. So we fully insulate our digesters. Next slide, please, Kira. So what you see on the outside is just the skin. There's a tank, the digester tank is inside. And we have an insulation layer then in between the two, and we keep the digester nice and warm. And then you get optimal digestion processes winter and summer. So, you know, you're going to be able to rely on it any time of the year. And the next slide, please, Kira. Now, we've also designed in this is our microcontroller. And so the unit is a bit like the controls you have in your washing machine or your dishwasher. It's fully automated, and At the moment, we're working on sending data back to a smartphone app so you can monitor your digester on your phone. And we're just beginning testing that now in the next week. Next slide, please. So we want to combine in, modern technology with our digesters. So as I say, not only have we designed digesters for domestic settings, we've also designed ones for cafes and delis or any other type of in a business that produces food waste. And at the moment, we've designed up to about 12 to 15 tons of food waste per year. So these are our largest digesters that we're going to be installing at the moment. Next slide, Kira, thanks. So one of the beauties and the big difference between anaerobic digestion and aerobic or composting is that you can pretty much treat any type of food waste that is generated in your household. That can be cooked, uncooked, meats, oils, etc. You see the whole list there, but also liquid wastes can go in, like, you know, if you have maybe a yogurt that's gone off, or say a marmalade that's that's gone moldy in your press. All of these wastes can go into a digester, unlike generally a standard composter. So, and next slide, please, Kira. And you can see there the difference. It's listed down, so it doesn't require a carbon source. You know, generally you have to mix sawdust or cardboard when you're composting. You don't have to do that with anaerobic digestion. It creates a gas, a biogas that you can use yourself for cooking, and you get a constant supply of fertilizer. So it's completely different, really, to composting in that it can take pretty much anything that's produced in the household. So this slide here shows the conversion rate. So for every ton of food waste that's digested, you can that'll convert to about 100 kilograms of equivalent of compressed gas. So that's an awful lot of gas. I was mentioning earlier about the domestic digesters. A standard household would produce about half a ton of food waste per year, 5 or 6 person household. So you can get actually about 4 or 5 gas cylinders worth of food waste, of gas from that food waste. So an awful lot of food waste. And another important element for us, and one of the reasons we think that the food system is badly broken, is that there's a disconnect between the food supply and with food coming from all over the world to feed us, even in Ireland, that there should be more of an emphasis on growing food locally. And you get a lot of from every ton of food waste, you get approximately 8 kilograms of nitrogen, 1.2 kilograms of potassium, and 3.4 kilograms of phosphorus. 1.2 of phosphorus and 3.4 of potassium. So there's a lot of nutrient available in the liquid that comes off a digester. So you're using those then to grow food locally. So next slide, please, Kira. So we're quite interested in permaculture, and again, this is using the value and valuing renewable resources. So you have renewable resources in your food that you reuse, and you don't produce any waste, and you grow more food locally. And again, this all reduces the carbon miles associated with not only getting rid of your waste, but also in importing food. Next slide shows, this is our own polytunnel that we set up last year, and all the fertilizer that we use, the liquid fertilizer, is from our digester, and we've grown amazing crops inside in this tunnel and outside as well. But so the idea there is that, again, it's a completely circular economy. Your own food waste you convert into energy, which you can cook with, and then the liquid then you use locally to create and grow more food. So again, it's getting back to the old ways, I suppose, thinking about my mum living rurally in Galway. 60-70 years ago, that, you know, most food was produced locally, and we really need to start getting back to that again, where, you know, the majority of our food is coming from within sort of 20-30 kilometer radius, and even with our type of system, on your doorstep. So there's zero food miles. Next slide, please. So again, there's a few other benefits. We all know that when you mix food waste with other types of waste like plastics, it's very difficult to recycle those plastics. And it's also very difficult then to get the value out of the food waste. So when you treat it at source, that then you get the most benefit from it. You've reduced truck movements, obviously. We want to get trucks off the road. The biogas offsets the fossil fuel gas that you use. And as I said just now, the digestate that comes from the anaerobic digester is used locally for growing more food. So again, you're reducing your carbon emissions associated with food waste in many ways. Next slide. Yeah, that's me. And apologies for the mishap there at the start, but I'd gladly take any questions if anybody has any.
Thank you, Kieran. That was a wonderful presentation, and it was worth the wait. I have worked in the biogas industry. I did my specialization in biogas before, so I have a quick question around, you know, what is the percentage of biogas, you know, what is the distribution of biogas, and how do you purify it to be fed further, for further use?
You don't actually have to purify it. The only thing that we have a gas filter on our system, and it removes hydrogen sulfide, which is that really smelly gas. So otherwise you can feed it directly into your cooker in your house. And we feed a standard biogas hob. We just changed the jets on the hob itself to be able to use biogas. And so it's as simple as that, or you can use a biogas stove otherwise.
Perfect. We have another question in the audience. Mary, would you like to put forward your question?
Yes, thank you. I think you've partially answered it. Kieran, it's Mary Morrissey here from the Architects Department.
Well, hi, Mary. How are you?
Hi, how are you? I was reading your literature, and if you want to pipe the gas so it is possible to pipe it to a domestic gas cooker, but that you just need to modify the jets. Is that?
Yeah, they're like in a standard hob. You have small little jets that the gas is fed through. And with biogas, because the energy in biogas is less than a standard gas, you need to supply more gas. So it's just a matter of putting in a jet with a larger hole, basically, that supplies more gas. And then you get the same, it burns the exact same as a normal gas as hob would.
Right. And just one other question in regards to the installation. Do you install that gas like with gas? You know, it kind of sometimes has to be certified when it's been installed, and that do you
yeah.
do the installation, or would you have to get a specialist?
It would be a specialist to guarantee it. Like we supply the equipment that can provide you the gas. Now, there's safety is a big thing. People are when they hear of gas, they're always very concerned. But biogas, particularly at this size, is completely different to a gas cylinder. Like a gas cylinder is at very high pressures and it contains a lot of gas. And if there is any issue with a leak in the house, that whole gas cylinder will empty into your house. And obviously, that'll be a huge problem. With biogas, you've got very small volumes of gas being produced on a daily basis, and the bag that the gas is stored in isn't under pressure. So to actually bring it into your house, you need to turn on a gas pump. It's a 20-watt pump that we supply with the unit, and that's it. And you connect it to your cooker or your biogas hob. But the danger from it is absolutely minuscule. compared to a gas cylinder.
Okay, I hope I'm not hogging all the questions. Can I ask one more, and then I promise I'll.
Yeah, sure, Mary.
How the bag that contains the gas, how robust is that? Presumably, if it's in the garden somewhere, you know, do you need to enclose it within a picket fence or something?
Yeah, it'd be ideal. Like the it's very robust, but it is light, and with the high wind, you know, you need to put it in an area that it won't get blown away. But that's about it. Like it's a very robust bag, and it inflates and deflates as you add food waste and as you use the gas. The beauty of it is one of the things we say on some of our brochures is it's a cylinder, gas cylinder that doesn't empty, because even if you do empty it, it fills again, you know, unlike a standard gas cylinder that you have to go and refill. So once you stay feeding food waste into the digester, it'll stay producing gas.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome, Mary.
There's one more question at the in the chat there. So yeah. Thomas, I don't know if you want to come off mic and ask, or I can read it out.
Hello, Kieran. How are you?
Hi, Thomas.
Yeah, I suppose my quantity sphere and background is coming out here. I'm just wondering the cost of a domestic unit and and connecting it back to your cooker. What would that be?
Well, we've started with supplying a base model which has heating controls, but everything else then is manual. There's a manual mixing pump and a manual dosing pump. It's very easy to operate.
Yeah.
And we're a bit like Tesla. We are expensive at the moment, because these units are hand built and in low numbers. But the retail cost of one of those is 3,200 plus VAT.
Right. Okay.
And then for our automated ones, they're up 4,800 plus VAT.
Would there be a payback on it, or I'm sure you've worked that
out.
Look,
I suppose what we say is the payback varies. It depends on how you use it. Like, for example, if you use it for growing more food, like we have been doing, you really get huge value from it, because not only, like, you can produce about 150 euros worth of gas a year from it, you also reduce your bin charges, depending on what part of the country you're in. You'll negate the having to have a brown bin and the cost of that. And then the liquid fertilizer for me is the key to our system. It's you're growing more food, you're creating this micro circular economy. And like if I weighed all the tomatoes that we produced this year from using our liquid fertilizer alone, it would certainly be in the hundreds of euros.
On the waste itself, Kieran, is there a difference in the levels of energy that will be created, we'll say, if from a kilo of carrots versus a kilo of meat?
The simple rule of thumb is if it makes you fat, it'll produce a lot of gas. If it's right, lettuce, if it's lettuce or a salad, it won't. So
like ourselves, so yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So anything like butter or cream, yeah, you get a lot of gas off it.
Right. Okay. I hear you. Yeah, that's me. Thanks very much, Kieran.
You're welcome, Thomas.
Thanks so much for that presentation, Kieran. Really insightful and very informative.
Thanks.
So just to introduce our next speaker, is Eshna. Eshna is currently the Program Manager at Merits, a new innovation think space based in Nice, supporting digital and tech startups in the Mid-Eastern region. A resource recovery and sustainability engineer, Eshna has been fascinated about molecular manufacturing and the potential that new technologies hold to solve major global challenges. An avid blogger, she loves to write about new trends in the ecosystem to bring forward tools and technologies that are transforming our society. Some of these articles can be found in the likes of Medium, Genetic Literacy Project, and Heliox Works portals. Eshna, over to yourself.
Thank you, Kira, for that lovely introduction. I will just start sharing my screen. Can you all see it?
That's all good, Eshna. Yep, away you go.
Perfect. So let's dive into some facts, stats, and trends. So a bag of salad leaves, an unfinished milk carton, imperfect veggies are just a few examples of how households contribute towards food waste. Everything we put in the bin has a negative impact on the environment, and it's our contribution towards climate change. From farm to fork, everything, growing, harvesting, processing, transportation, contributes to greenhouse gas emissions to reach our plates. And when we throw away that food, it releases more greenhouse gases as it rots in the landfills. So where in the food value chain does the food get lost or wasted? While there is no commonly agreed definition of food loss and food waste, according to FAO, United Nations, food loss occurs in the early stages of the food supply chain due to factors like legal frameworks, production and supply systems, and market standards such as ripeness, color, or the shape. Whereas food waste occurs at consumer and retail level. These are the decisions made by food suppliers, retailers, and consumers. And it includes some items like discarded food, degraded products, and products that were damaged while in transition. According to the latest Food Waste Index report, 61% of this waste comes from households, followed by 26% from food services and 13% from retail. The global carbon emissions linked with unconsumed produce is between 8 to 10%. So what do we do with our food waste? How do we green our food waste and turn it into opportunities? In Europe, 20% of all food produced is wasted, and less than half of it is recycled into biogas or used for composting or reused as animal feed. Creating zero waste is absolutely desirable, but to build a sustainable food system, we need to adopt a circular approach. Traditionally, we follow a take-make-dispose system, where products created are used only once with the intention of being discarded at the end of its life cycle. However, with the circular approach, activities at each point across the value chain is designed to maintain the value of products as well as the resources that have gone into it in the economy for as long as possible, thus reducing waste generation and lowering the greenhouse gas emissions and other environmental impacts. So turning waste into opportunities has been an area of interest for both industries and researchers for a long time. For example, on an average, we consume, or the world consumes, 2.25 billion cups of coffee every day, generating about 18 million tons of coffee ground waste. Typically, brewing coffee only utilizes about 1% of all the valuable compounds in the coffee, leaving behind what we call as coffee waste that is rich in lipids and polyphenols, minerals, and proteins. Café Bueno, a Danish startup, is upcycling the coffee ground into ingredients that can be used in the cosmetic, nutraceutical, and food industry. Similar to what Cafe Bueno is doing, there's another Polish company called EcoBean that's been producing coffee logs out of the spent coffee grounds. You can produce clean energy. They burn longer than the wood and give more energy than wood. Moving on to the next bit. So food processing actually generates a lot of side streams, byproducts, or waste streams that we often overlook. These streams can help us tap into new sources of protein as well as other value added products. Some of the active projects in EU include Valo Cake. So they are exploring rapeseed press cake, which is an agricultural residue that we get after processing the oil seed such as rapeseed. Annually, about 49 million tons of rapeseed press cake is left as a residue, and this is rich in dietary fiber and high in protein content. Given that the consumers are now exploring towards plant-based alternatives, this actually presents a great opportunity for individuals prone to allergy. There are other two projects that are exploring rapeseed ingredients as well, taste to meat and dairy alternative drinks and yogurts, both based out of EU. An Irish company, Glanbia, is leading a project that deals with the agricultural way, or rather than that, a way waste stream. So their project name is AgriChem Way. There is a waste stream that is left behind after processing whey and other dairy products, which is absolutely rich in different nutrients. After the whey has been extracted, after all the other valuable nutrients have been extracted, this stream is often overlooked. And Glanbia is looking to produce sustainable lactic acid out of this that can be further used into biodegradable plastics. Similarly, fruits and vegetables processing facilities leave aside pulps, peels, and seeds. And plant-based industry, beverage industry especially, offers very attractive side streams ranging from soy, almond, oats. Renewable mills is creating upcycled ingredients from these pulp streams to meet all our baking needs, including cake mixes and flours. Now, as we are all a part of the food value chain, it's important to understand how we can shift our consumption patterns as well. So we often come across date labels stating used by, best before, sell by. It's important to understand what they stand for. For example, best before represents the quality of the food, whereas used by represents the food safety aspect. After best before date, one can still consume the food. It's very likely to be safe. It's likely to be safe, and the quality of the food product might alter a bit. However, it can still be repurposed with other food products. However, one should not consume produce after the use by date, even if it looks fine, even if it smells fine. It may make you sick. However, the sell-by or display date does not affect us as consumer. It's more to help retailers control their stocks. Now, we often, you know, find mold growing on some food items when we open the fridge, similar to what you'd find on breads or cheese. There'd be mold growing on. So for hard food items such as hard cured meats, hams and salamis, and hard cheeses or root vegetables like carrots, the mold can be removed safe and the food item can still be consumed safely. Whereas for soft foods, the mold spreads faster in softer medium and it may not be visible to naked eye, but it's very likely that it has affected the entire product, so it's safe to discard it. Now, there's several initiatives, several apps across EU to share, exchange, or buy food that would be wasted otherwise. And these include, but they're not limited to, Food Cloud. It's a platform that connects supermarkets and retail stores with local authorities and community partners to collect food surplus and redistribute it. Wasteless is another AI tool that enables dynamic pricing for perishable items that are at a risk of being thrown away. Olio is an app that you can use to connect with your neighbors and local businesses to share surplus food. And Kiche is something as consumers we can all use. So all you have to do is upload your shopping receipts on the app, and the app suggests you recipes. It gives you spoiler alert around the food that you've bought. And earlier we had Ashling from Positive Carbon. They're working with hotels and catering businesses to track and monitor food waste created in their kitchens. Some of the other tips and tricks which are our little wins along the way include repurposing food, such as stems and skins and leaves of the vegetables that we buy, or just as simple as freezing herbs in cubes and making stock out of, you know, vegetable scraps and so on. And try to always freeze before the use-by date if you intend that you may not be using the product by the end of its use date. Don't bin it. You can always try new recipes with leftovers or with what you have in the fridge. And it's good to sort of maintain a food diary if you are looking to control, you know, to if you're trying to control what goes into your bin. And what can't be saved can be composted. Composting provides healthy soil. It's a way of repurposing our food waste to nourish the soil. And you can always talk to the environmental awareness officer in KCC to learn more about the initiatives and kinds of waste collection available. Here's a list of other initiatives that you can find across the internet. Stopfoodwaste.ie hosts several events across different months, such as composting training. You can become a part of Tidy Towns and other community groups. Love Food, Hate Waste does offer creative leftover recipes, and they're definitely a great source to read about food waste. European Union Food Information Council is a great place to understand the science behind food and health. And you can always sign up for courses around how to tackle food waste on platforms like FutureLearn, Coursera, and so on. The world needs to change the way it produces and consumes food. For long, our society has rested on take-make-waste model. To build a sustainable food system, we need to rethink our approach towards the way we produce and consume, thus turning waste into opportunities. Therefore, doing more and better with less and limited. Thank you.
That was brilliant, Ashna. Thanks so much for that. I always love to see the creativity that people can come out of with food waste. The Glambia example reminded me of one company that used seafood and the chitin that was in that and converted it into biodegradable material. Yeah, just to open any question. Any questions for Ashna? And if not, I have one, I guess.
So
I guess on your research, like, what's the main items that are wasted in Irish households, or do you have any data on that?
So some of the most wasted food items would be bananas, potatoes, and tomatoes. And around, at least in the UK, we don't have exact stats of Irish community, but in UK, around 2 to 3 million bananas are actually dumped into the waste bin.
Wow.
Not so far from my neighbours, though.
You need to cage your bananas before you buy them. All off you go.
Hi, Ashna. Quick one for you. I live in the middle of the countryside, folks, and I come from a rural background, to say the least. But something that people forget is that farmers sometimes will take food waste. Now, nothing that's strong smelling, like celery, won't work. But say you have cabbage leaves, broccoli leaves, carrots, something like that. I mean, apples, pears. You'd be amazed what the cattle and sheep adore, and they love anything sweet. So carrots is definitely one of their favourites. So all I'm just saying is, if there's a local farmer beside you, you could always collect it and just say, here, guys, would this be something you consider taking off us every week or every day, depending on the school or something like that? It might be an option.
Absolutely. And if all of you in the audience, if you have any tips or things that you've been following as part of, you know, your regime on reduced waste, please feel free to share them in the chat, and we'd love to adopt them as well.
Actually, can I ask one thing? How many people here are DIYers? Do you grow it yourself, or does anybody even try it maybe in a small scale?
I think the pandemic has driven the DIY movement, and there is a community based out of Galway that are working around DIY stuff, Grow Harvest, and they've been, and in Kildare as well, we have Lucy, who sort of promotes, you know, growing your own stuff and how you can go ahead with it. So they're definitely small movements, and with the aim of, I think, Kildare Climate Action Week, we do plan on bringing all those faces to the community as well, so they feel they can find one person around their house as well. So Stop Food Waste IE connects all these communities together. We have Cove Tiny Towns, we have, you know, Limerick Tidy Towns as well, and so on with each little county. So you can always get connected with them.
Brilliant, thanks. And just one final thing, if somebody does want to do training, NOTS, N-O-T-S, they're the National Organic Training Skills Net. They're based in Leitrim, and they do an awful lot of very subsidized or very cheap, if not free, courses on DIYing, organic gardening, etc. around the country. So I'm just saying, if anyone is linking to them, they're actually extremely good and great to talk to. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Paula, for that. I see Mary's typing something, so we'll just wait for her to finish. Or I think the pandemic did give us all the time to grow and get back to the roots, but I guess with everyone returning to normal, we'd find it harder to grow it ourselves again, but we hope to do our bit as time passes by. But this was an absolutely great session. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us today and, you know, being the audience that you were. Thank you so much. And if you have any questions, anything, please feel free to just pop in a message to any one of us here on the chat today, and we'd be happy to get back to you with more information. Thank you, Kieran. Thank you, Ashley, for joining us. And this also happens to be the last event of Kildare Climate and Energy Week. And we hope that you all enjoyed and took away some bit of information with all of these events that we organized over the week. And a big shout out to Paula, Kira, Peter, Sarah, the entire Climate Action team for making this happen and getting this initiative up and running in Kildare.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks so much, Ashna. Thanks, Kieran. Thanks for the great session, guys.